Hi everybody. Today we're going to go ahead and listen to chapter 4 of My Dog Skip by William Morris. Chapter 4, War Days. In the first 2.5 years of his life, Skip was a war dog, because I was a war boy. He was as much a part of World War II for me as Roosevelt, Churchill, Hitler, and Hirohito. The war itself was a glorious and incomparable thing, a great panorama intended purely for the gratification of one's childhood imagination. And since old Skip had an adventuresome heart, I believe he too sensed something monumentous was touching our lives. My pals and I never missed a war film. Skip always patiently waited outside the theater until the movie was over and we joined him again. How my contemporaries and I hated the Japanese soldiers who pried off fingernails, sawed off eyelashes with razors, and bayoneted babies. We loathed the Germans also, but slightly less so because they looked like us. And the English, with whom we shared a common tongue, and the free French and Russians, they were good fellows, and the Chinese were mysterious but friendly, and the Italians, pronounced I-Italians, were cowardly, but in captivity, lovable, full of song, and more than willing to change sides. I promised myself that if the town was ever captured, I would retire to the deepest recesses around Peak Tenerife, with Skip and the other boys as a guerrilla fighter. And if I was ever caught and put before a firing squad, I would yell, "Long live America!" We climbed Brickyard Hill and stood at its highest pinnacle, with pre-war Woolworth binoculars, searching for any signs of junkers or zeros whose shape we had memorized from 25-cent books on enemy aircraft. And when Skip saw us looking up into the heavens, he looked too. Whether mimicking us or not, I was never quite sure. I kept a diary of all the crucial battles, and which I followed every day in the pages of the Memphis Commercial Appeal and the Jackson Daily News. And I kept entries of more personal matters also. I came across this diary not long ago, all shriveled and yellowing in the same box where I had found old Skip's photograph. My handwriting on the first page said, "In the event of an emergency, contact my dog Skip." One of the entries in my boyish scrawl declared, "Skip is smart. Skip is very smart," and went on to describe how only the week before he had supported us in trying to uncover a German spy network in town. The circumstances were these. The little diary reminded me because of the Southland oil refinery, a few miles from town, and the active flow of commerce on the river, I had surmised that our town had been chosen by Berlin as a prime target, and hence we considered it our responsibility to keep eyes keenly out for alien espionage agents. On that ominous forenoon the previous week, we had noticed a large blanket hanging on a clothesline behind a house near the town dump, with a swastika emblazoned on the cloth. Immediately suspicious, I told my diary Pee-wee, Muttonhead, Henji, Skip, and I hid in a nearby grove of chinaberry trees, and for long moments surveyed the house. Three or four enigmatic people kept going in and out. We forthwith hastened to police headquarters and reported our discovery to Sheriff Raines, who was drinking iced tea in a wicker chair on the sidewalk. "Oh, heck," he said, "I know them people," and proceeded to tell us the swastika was an Indian symbol on an old Indian blanket. "That don't matter," he advised us. "You boys and the dog continue to keep your eyes out at all times." Well, Skip never cared much for the radio, but whenever he listened to Hitler giving a speech on our shortwave at home, he had a most uncommon reaction. Cocking an ear to the Führer's burning words and shouts, he would sit there for a moment imbibing this bombast, and then with his ears twitching as in pain, began strutting around the room, emitting deranged little howls, his snout lifted mightily upward, much as he had done in the cemetery when we accosted the man making the shortcut. Often was the time we had to turn off the radio to get him to stop. Why did he never once do this when listening to Mussolini? Was this part of his ESP in reading my own moods and matters? Whatever it was, I never knew a dog so down on Hitler. The boy who had lived in the big white house next door had enlisted in the army when he was 17, and now he was fighting in Europe, and we exchanged victory mail, which we called V-mail, and I sent him reports of ball games and sometimes oatmeal cookies, the good kind. And one fabulous day, a substantial package came to me from France, and I brought it into my room to open it. Always curious about novel and unexpected items, Skip began poking it with his nose. When I tore off the paper and opened the top of the box, he put his head inside to see what was there. It was a real German helmet with the name of the soldier, Willie, carved inside it, and also a German belt with its engraving, Gott mit uns, and an iron cross, and German money, and postcards of German stormtroopers. Skip was intrigued by the helmet, and when I placed it on the floor, he sniffed it some more and then pushed it around with a paw. Tolbert, an old man who was doing some handiwork around the house, was fascinated with that helmet too, and sometimes I would let him wear it home, and he would walk off down the back alley doing a goose step the way the Germans did, Skip following with sharp interest right behind him. Then he would turn and wave at me, snapping his heels and giving me the Heil Hitler sign. Later, I wore the helmet, the iron cross, and the belt down Main Street one Saturday afternoon, Skip at my heels, and all the country boys standing on the corner came to look them over. Gott mit uns, one of them said. Now what's that supposed to say? God with us, I replied. Yeah? Now ain't that something? Them Germans think they got God on their side. In addition to exploring the vicinity for spies, we pursued other constructive patriotic activities, and Skip was closely involved in these lofty schemes also. Dominating this good old time was the image of Franklin D. Roosevelt, our president, his voice on the radio, his face with dark rings under his eyes on the newsreels, and because of him, my father and I planted a big victory garden in our backyard, raising food on our own because much of it was scarce, and we had to have special ration stamps to buy it. We grew long rows of snap beans, tomatoes, beets, radishes, corn, squash, and rutabagas, and a unique breed of swamp turnip called Zubu, the seeds of which the hanger-on around Panther Creek had once given us. And since we lived in the flat part of town, this was rich, loamy delta land, and our vegetables came out bountifully and fast. Daddy and I worked every late afternoon of the war until dark, chopping and weeding. Old Skip relished that garden, its fresh, full aromas, following us down the rows as we worked, dipping his nose in the soil so that he looked like a dirt dauber, and sometimes going to sleep under the tomato vines or next to our scarecrow with whom he had established a makeshift truce. Every Saturday morning at 10 o'clock, there was the kitty matinee at the Dixie Theater, and this too became a symbolic cosmos of the war effort. On the screen would be the latest chapter of the Spy Smasher series involving grisly enemy agents, a newsreel of the fighting around the globe, and a full-length Western, Roy Rogers, or Gene Autry, or Lash LaRue, or Don Red Berry. And many of the country people would bring their lunches and paper sacks and stay all day, right until sunset, watching Roy or Gene or Lash or Red all over again, joining the town children in the cheering the inevitable scene in which the hero dashes across the range on his horse to rescue his friends from dismemberment or other catastrophe. If we collected enough coat hangers and tinfoil, which would be used to be making bullets for our soldiers, and brought them to the Dixie Theater, the manager would let us into the kitty matinee free of charge. Hence, Skip and I would wander the alleyways of town twice a week or more, searching for discarded empty cigarette packages because of the tinfoil inside of them. Camel cigarette packages were the most desirable of all because their tinfoil, it was said, made better bullets. I taught Skip to help locate these empty cigarette packages, and given his pervasive intelligence and diligence, which by now should be apparent to even the most jaundiced of readers, in little time at all, he had mastered the search, bringing to me many empty packages in his teeth from the ditches, gullies, pastures, and undergrowth abutting our prolific alleys, as proud when he found one as the most princely young knight in quest of the Grail. It was also integral to the kitty matinee that if you agreed to perform in the talent show preceding the action on the screen, either you were permitted in without having to pay, or, as usually the case with my friends and me, who were already allowed in free because of our tinfoil, the manager would reward you with a dime, the price of the normal ticket. Often was the Saturday the others and I would appear in the talent show, and this led to two salutary things. One, I could save my dimes and buy chocolate bars and bubblegum on the black market. And two, the manager, finally convinced that Old Skip himself contributed substantial quantities of the tinfoil, allowed him to come to the matinee with us. On four straight Saturdays, Skip stood on the stage with Henji, Big Boy, Muttonhead, and me as we sang a quartet rendition of the Marines hymn, which was dedicated to all the Marines in San Diego. The Kaysen song for the Army in North Africa and England, Anchors Away for the sailors in the Pacific, and Off We Go into the Wild Blue Yonder for all our pilots, navigators, bombers, bombardiers, tail gunners, and engine mechanics everywhere. Later, when the films came on, Skip would sit in the seat next to me, observing the transactions on the screen for a while before resting his face on my arm and going to sleep. I often suspected that Skip had a natural compulsion toward repulsive smells, though not those as heightened as the skunks, which had so debilitated him previously. Oh, Elijah has joined us on the couch. I'll show you. Yeah, over there. Hi, Raja. Do you want to say hi to the kids? No, are you sleeping? Okay. Sorry, guys. But you might like to see Raja for a second. Okay, where was that? Just like in school, I've lost my place. Let's sit in the seat. Right, I'll start here. I'm on page 42 at the first full paragraph. I often suspected that Skip had a natural compulsion toward repulsive smells, though not those as heightened as the skunks, which had so debilitated him previously. The truth is, however, that he enjoyed wallowing in various peculiar substances and unusual elements, and would come home with those vile odors on him. Please do not ask me what. My mother refused to allow him in the house until these odors of their own accord wore off. It suggests something about the sweep of those war days, however, that my mother, who occasionally bought Evening in Paris perfume at the drugstore, would in such instances greet Skip at the door. He's got Evening in Berlin on him again, or now, dread it, he's wearing some Evening in Tokyo. As vivid as yesterday, I remember the springtime Friday nights of school. My friends and Skip and I strolling along to the broad boulevard of our blue and yellow Cub Scout caps on the way to a war movie downtown. First, Yank into Tokyo, perhaps, or the Fighting Seabees, or the Purple Heart, and the radios from the imposing houses blared the war news from London or the Pacific, or the words of Roosevelt or Churchill echoing out into the supple darkness. While Skip roamed among the wisteria or the rhododendrons or tulips along the way, there was something in this I sensed, just a shred of boyhood emotion and memory, that in the echoes of the radios in the boulevard domiciles lay the fragile, beleaguered fate of us. How to know this then? It was there, somehow in the trees and lawns, the birds and the wind chimes, the clouds and the stars, and even in Old Skip's roamings in the dew-touched shadows. It was along this very boulevard, on another night, D-Day, 1944, that Henji and Muttonhead and I tied tin cans to the end of a long string and pulled them along the middle of the street in a noisy, commemorative parade, with Skip moving along right behind the cans. The day the Japanese surrendered and the war was over, Skip and I were in the house with the old handyman, Tolbert, who was hanging some wallpaper, and we waited all day for the announcement the radio said was coming. And Tolbert was unable to get much work done because of the excitement, so we threw a baseball in the yard for a while and shelled pecans and shot a few baskets and tossed sticks for Skip and got him to climb the elm tree for squirrels. And while the radio roared out at us from the bedroom window, then Truman, the new president, came on and said the Japanese had given up. And Tolbert and I shouted and leapt and danced around and hugged each other, and Skip, catching the mood, leapt and danced around too. And when we whacked each other on the back and leapt some more, and then I sent Skip to Bozo's for some bologna to celebrate. And that concludes chapter 4, everybody. All right, we'll read the next one tomorrow. Enjoy the rest of your day.